Gabapentin do not act on GABA receptors. Is it true? Gabapentin is one of the drugs which is used as an analgesic, as well as it is also used as an anti-epileptic. It can be used as an analgesic in conditions like the post-herpetic neuralgia, where the pain produced after the herpes infection is going to be controlled by gabapentin. And it can also be used as an anti-epileptic, particularly in the treatment of focal seizures, gabapentin can be used. But how this gabapentin acts, whether it is having any action on the GABA receptors, or otherwise how it shows its anti-epileptic as well as analgesic action. And why the name of this gabapentin starts with the letters GABA, whether it is structurally related with the GABA or not. So let us see all these interesting facts in this video. If you like this video, please subscribe to our channel and click the bell icon for getting the notifications. So this is the structure of gabapentin. And we can observe that the name is made up of gabapentin. That means it's having some relation with the structure of GABA. Now, what is a GABA? GABA is nothing but the gamma amino butyric acid. So we can observe this is the alpha carbon, this is the beta carbon, and this is the gamma carbon. So at the gamma position, an amino group is there, and it is a butyric acid. So it's a gamma amino butyric acid. And we can observe the same moiety in the gabapentin. So this is the alpha, and this is the beta, and this is the gamma. So we can again observe the gamma amino butyric acid within the structure of gabapentin. In other words, gabapentin is a structure made up of GABA as well as a cyclohexyl ring, which are connected at the beta carbon. So in this way, gabapentin is a structural analog of the GABA, and it is a modified structure with a cyclohexyl substitution at the beta position. Now, what is the action of this gabapentin, whether it acts on the GABA receptors or not? Let us see that. Gabapentin is a structural analog of the GABA, so we can expect that it acts on the GABA receptor. But it was practically observed that gabapentin is having no affinity on the GABA receptors. You know, GABA receptors are two types, GABA A and GABA B receptors. And it was practically found that gabapentin is having no affinity towards the GABA A receptors as well as the GABA B receptors. Then how it acts? And it was found that gabapentin is having some affinity on the calcium channels, but it does not directly block the calcium channels. It blocks a few of the subunits on the calcium channels which are present on the presynaptic neurons. Thereby, gabapentin can block the calcium-mediated release of the neurotransmitters. This is the one of the possible mechanism for the gabapentin. Even the exact mechanism by which the gabapentin shows the anti-epileptic action is not clear, the blocking of this calcium channel may be a possible mechanism for its anti-epileptic action. Now, suppose this is a presynaptic neuron, and this presynaptic neuron is having the neurotransmitters. Glutamate is one of a excitatory neurotransmitter which is responsible for the neuronal excitation within the CNS. In order to release this glutamate, the calcium is important. This calcium can enter into the presynaptic membrane, which produces the exocytosis, which results in the fusion of this synaptic vesicles with the synaptic membrane, releasing the glutamate. Now, this released glutamate can act on the postsynaptic membrane, and this postsynaptic membrane may be equipped with the various receptors. For example, it can be equipped with the AMPA receptors, which are the receptors for the glutamate, which are fast-acting inotropic receptors. And other inotropic receptors are the NMDA receptors, which are coupled with the both sodium as well as the calcium channels. Now, when this glutamate acts on any of these postsynaptic receptors, like AMPA receptors, they open the sodium channels, so sodium can enter into the postsynaptic membrane, which causes the depolarization of the postsynaptic membrane. In this way, the released glutamate can cause the excitation of the postsynaptic membrane by activation of the either AMPA or NMDA receptors. But what happens in the epilepsy? In the epilepsy, the glutamate is excessively released, which acts on the more number of glutamate receptors, resulting in the high frequency neuronal excitation. This high frequency neuronal excitation can be observed as an epilepsy in the patients. Now, epilepsy is nothing but a high frequency neuronal discharge which is exacerbating the postsynaptic neurons very excessively. Now, how we can treat this high frequency neuronal discharge? So one of the goal is to block these sodium channels, otherwise by blocking the AMPA and NMDA receptors. Otherwise, and the target is to block this release of this glutamate by inhibition of the entry of calcium, which results in the exocytosis. Now in this context, let us see how this gabapentin acts. Calcium can enter into the presynaptic membrane through the ion channels, and these ion channels are equipped with the different types of subunits. So one of the subunit is the gamma subunit, and another subunit is the delta 1 subunit. This delta 1 subunit is connected with the another subunit alpha 2 subunit. When this alpha 2 delta 1 subunit is activated, it can activate the release of this alpha 1 subunit, which is then associated with the other subunits to form a pore through which the calcium can enter. And when these alpha 1 subunits are activated, the calcium can enter into this presynaptic membrane, which can enhance the exocytosis and release the neurotransmitters like the glutamate. Now in the epilepsy, the calcium can more enter into the presynaptic membrane, which results in the excessive release of the neurotransmitters like the glutamate. Here the gabapentin plays a key role. Gabapentin blocks this alpha 2 delta 1 subunit, thereby it inhibits the entry of the calcium into the presynaptic membrane. In this way, gabapentin can block the release of the neurotransmitters like the glutamate. So this is one of the possible mechanisms by which the gabapentin can inhibit the neuronal response, thereby it produces anti-epileptic as well as analgesic actions. Saturation kinetics of absorption. Gabapentin can be absorbed through the intestine, but it shows some saturation kinetics. So gabapentin can be transported across the small intestine by specialized transporter LAT1, L-amino acid transporter 1. Now this gabapentin can enter into the systemic circulation through the intestine through the LAT1 transporters. Then it can enter into the brain by various transporters, among which again the LAT1 is one of the important transporters. And now at the intestine, the number of LAT1 transporters is limited. When the gabapentin dose is increased, the LAT1 transporters are saturated so that the gabapentin cannot be absorbed further. Since this LAT1 is a capacity limited transport system, as we increase the dose of gabapentin, the absorption is not parallelly increased. So we can observe a inverse relation between the gabapentin dose and its absorption. As we increase the dose, the absorption of gabapentin decreases because of saturation of LAT1 transporters. So it is one of an advantage with the gabapentin, because if gabapentin is given at a high dose, the entire dose may not be absorbed because of the saturation of the LAT1. That's why gabapentin is safe even in the overdoses, because as the dose increases, the absorption decreases. Now what is the dose of the gabapentin? The dose of the gabapentin depends on for which purpose it is going to be used. For example, in case of postherpetic neuralgia, the gabapentin at a first day it is given at a dose of 100 mg once a daily, and at the second day the dose is going to be increased by further 100 mg. So dose is given as a 200 mg twice daily, and at the third day the dose can be further increased to 300 mg thrice daily. So in this way, the dose of this gabapentin can be gradually increased up to the third day. After the third day, the dose can be maintained with further increments, and the maximum dose that can be achieved is the 1800 mg thrice daily. Now in case of epilepsy, it can be given to the children with 3 to 12 years at a dose of 10 to 15 mg per kg per day, and for adults greater than 12 years, the dose may be variable from the 900 to 1800 mg per day. These doses are not given as a single dose, they should be divided such that they are given 3 times daily. Side effects. As we have seen that gabapentin is safe in overdoses and it does not produce some significant side effects, so it produces some mild side effects. And few of the important side effects of gabapentin are dizziness, drowsiness, somnolence, the sleepiness in the patient, and loss of coordination. And these are particularly important side effects of gabapentin, because it produces a drowsiness which may affect the daily activity in the patients. Where it is used? Just we have seen that gabapentin can be used in the postherpetic neuralgia. So this is a condition where the pain is going to be produced after the infection of herpes zoster. So in this postherpetic phase, we can observe burning, numbness, itching due to the enhanced neuronal response in the patients. And since gabapentin can inhibit the neuronal response by inhibition of the release of the neurotransmitters, it can suppress this exaggerated neuronal response, thereby it can control the pain sensation. Similarly, gabapentin can also be used in the conditions like the neuropathic pain. Neuropathic pain is associated with the allodynia. Allodynia is a condition where there is an exaggerated neuronal response resulting in the enhanced pain sensation without any external damage. Again, in such situation, gabapentin is proved to suppress the pain response. Another use of the gabapentin is in the treatment of focal seizures. Focal seizures will affect only some part of the brain and they produce a partial damage to the particular area of the brain. In such situations, gabapentin is proved useful, but gabapentin should not be given in the treatment of focal seizures which are associated with the generalized seizures. So that's about this gabapentin. Gabapentin is one of the drug which is a structural analog of the GABA. Even it is having the structural similarity with the GABA, but it does not have any action on the GABA A receptors or GABA B receptors. It cannot block the other receptors like the NMD and AMP receptors, but it have some action on the presynaptic calcium channels, particularly on the alpha 2 delta 1 subunit. And this gabapentin blocks this alpha 2 delta 1 subunit, which inhibits the entry of this calcium through the alpha 1 subunit into the presynaptic membrane. As the calcium entry is going to be inhibited, the exocytosis is going to be blocked and the release of the neurotransmitters is prevented. In this way, gabapentin can inhibit the release of the neurotransmitters, thereby it can decrease the neuronal response. That's why gabapentin can be used in the conditions like the postherpetic neuralgia as an analgesic as well as an anti-epileptic in the treatment of focal seizures. Thank you for watching this video.